Peace TV English, the solution for humanity.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. In the name of Allah, the Compassionate, the Merciful, all praise is due to Allah, and may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His Prophet Muhammad, his family, all of his companions and his followers until the day of judgment. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Peace be with you all. And I'd like to welcome you to this new episode of our series, Human Rights, A Muslim Perspective. We've already covered in the last episode some issues regarding the agreement between the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Universal Islamic Declaration of Human Rights, where there are many areas of agreement. We've covered many areas, and I will continue with the points of agreement, because all in all, many areas are agreed upon, such as the freedom of expression and opinion. Obviously, when we say the freedom of opinion and expression, this is bound by the Sharia in Islam, but probably in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, people can express themselves, even if that would mean some points of disagreement or controversy regarding certain points of morals and so on. And some people have taken this expression of freedom of expression out of bounds, and they cross boundaries, especially when it comes to the rights of others in respecting their own value system or their own holy beliefs, such as when they step on, for example, they say something bad or terrible about the prophets or about the symbols of religions or what is respected by people. As these countries, particularly those who have tendency to greater bounds and they extend the greater bounds of liberty, they would think that it is permissible for you to go into these areas and to express whatever means you'd have without having anyone to hold you accountable for it, especially when it comes to religious matters. Obviously, as you think that democracy and liberty are very much respected in some countries, then religions and the value system in other countries is very much respected, and therefore we have to have a mutual respect in this regard and also express ourselves clearly in these matters in accordance with reason, with understanding, with the interest to have coexistence and peace and harmony in the world. This is very important. Unless we do this, we will go into conflict, we will create an unhealthy atmosphere for people to act in a very hostile way. I think at the end, it's not in the interest of anyone, and maybe all of us as humans will pay a high price for this. So respecting others when we express our opinions has to be very much sensitive to the issues that are very critical to other people around. And today is not like yesterday. Today is different, where the media, the means of communication, have reached every corner of the world. Even the social media, where people can discuss things on small programs like WhatsApp or on Tango or Skype or anything of that sort, it may reach to others. Even if someone puts a small clip on YouTube, and others will carry it and it will spread all over the world. Twitter, for example, or Facebook, has made things known throughout the world in almost no time. That's why we have to be respective and careful of what we say. Now, in Islam, we know that everyone is responsible for the utterance of a word. And the Quran was clear in this, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned in the last ayahs revealed in the glorious Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah says, لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَإِنْ تُبْدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ تُخْفُوهُ يُحَاسِبْكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهِ فَيَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. For Allah is what is in the heavens and the earth, and whatever you expose or express outwardly or hide within your heart, whether you express it or you hide it, Allah will hold you accountable against that. Now that became very hard upon the companions because they said, well, we might have at times some bad ideas. We may think of sinning. And how would Allah hold us accountable that? That would be very, very hard upon us. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the second ayah after this said, آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمن كل آمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. The ayahs immediately after that talk about the forgiveness of when a person commits a mistake but immediately returns to this, and even if someone intends to do wrong but has not committed wrong, then that person will not be held accountable against that thinking or just the intention to do it. In fact, if a person stops from doing something that he thought about or she thought about because they were fearful of Allah's punishment, they were fearful that this was not right, then obviously they will be rewarded for that rather than to be punished. If they commit that wrongdoing, for example, then it will be counted as one bad deed. And if they intend to do something good in return and would not do it for any reason, particularly if they could not do it, if they forget to do it, it will be counted for them as one good deed. If they do it, then they have the opportunity to raise it up to 10 times. So they will be multiplied for a person. Allah is so generous. And therefore, even when you have those intentions, to say that you want to say anything is very bad. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ made sure that we need to guard our tongues not to fall in any mistake or to say something wrong. Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu reported that one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, when he said to him, Ya Rasulullah, أخبرني بعمل يدخلني الجنة ويباعدني عن النار. Tell me a deed that will make me enter Jannah and be away from hellfire. He said, لقد سألت عن أمر عظيم وإنه ليسير على من يسره الله عليه. He said, you have asked about a great matter, but it will be very easy for anyone whose Allah makes it easy for. تعبد الله ولا تشرك به شيئا. You worship Allah and do not associate any one or anything with Him. وتقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة وتصوم رمضان. And you establish Salah, you give out Zakah, and you fast the month of Ramadan. Then he said, ألا أدلك على أبواب الخير. Should I tell you about the doors of good? الصوم جنة. Sawm is a shield, or fasting is a shield. والصدقة تطفئ الخطيئة. And sadaqah, or charity, will turn off the sin, meaning that it will wipe it out. كما يطفئ الماء النار. As water will put off fire. وصلاة الرجل في جوف الليل. And the prayer of man or a person in the middle of the night. ثم تلا تتجافى جنوبهم عن المضاجع يدعون ربهم خوفا وطمعا ومما رزقناهم ينفقون. He again took the ayah as evidence in the glorious Quran in Surah Al-Sajda. Allah says, their sides will be turning from one to another, meaning they will be not letting their sides continue to sleep, but rather In fact, they will get up in the middle of the night and offer prayer because they establish the salah, they spend of what Allah has given them. That is their character. Then he said, أَلَا أَدُلُّكَ بِرَأْسِ الْأَمْرِ وَعَمُودِهِ وَذِرْوَةِ سَنَامِهِ قُلْتُ بَلَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. He said, should I tell you the head of the matter, the bone of the matter, the basic bone and post of the matter, and the top or helm of this matter? I said, of course, O Rasulullah. He said, the head of the matter is al-Islam, which is to submit to Allah's will and to single Him out in worship, and the real bone and backbone of Islam is as-salah. So salah is important, which is a connection. So starting with the belief, and secondly, with salah, which is the connection between a person and Allah, and the top of the helm is, in fact, al-jihadu fi sabilillah, struggle or fighting in the cause of Allah, provided that this goes with the conditions offered by scholars. It's not a free hand to give anyone the will and the ability to fight in the cause of Allah, except with the requirements given by scholars in this respect. Then he said, أَلَا أُخْبِرُكَ بِمِلَاكِ ذَلِكَ كُلِّ. Shouldn't I tell you what makes all of this working? And indeed, if you get it, you'll be able to get all of the what was mentioned before. I said, بَلَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. I said, yes, O Rasulullah. Then he held his tongue and he said, كُفَّ عَلَيْكَ هَذَا. Make sure that this is stopped. Keep this intact. Keep this inside your mouth. Then he said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَإِنَّ لَمُؤَاخَذُونَ بِمَا نَقُولُ. Are we going to be held responsible for what we say? He said, ثَكِلَتْكَ أُمُّكَ يَا مُعَاذ. O Mu'adh, may your mother lose you. That's an expression, not a dua against him, but that's how when someone is not aware of something, he said, ثَكِلَتْكَ أُمُّكَ, meaning, hey, be careful so that your mother may not lose you in this regard. وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسَ عَلَى وُجُوهِهِمْ أَوْ قَالَ عَلَى مَنَاقِرِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَسْرِنْتِهِمْ. Wouldn't be not the case that what puts people on their faces or with their noses first diving in hellfire except the consequences of their tongues, meaning what they have said. So this is very significant. Now, I said this hadith and I need to make some comment on it, but I have to give you a break, so please stay with us.
The value of money in the hereafter will be measured by its proper use in the present.
Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu anfiqu mimma razaqnakum min qabli an ya'tiya yawmun la bay'un fihi wa la khullatun wa la shafa'a.
According to the glorious Quran, one of the best ways to use your money is to spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by spreading His message of Islam. Peace TV is a non-profit Islamic satellite television channel that is primarily dedicated for just that cause, the proper presentation of Islam. It's a great choice to invest in it and a golden opportunity to purify your wealth in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Support Peace TV. Send your zakat and donations to IRFI Al Rayan Bank, 47 Calthorpe Road, Birmingham, UK, B151TH. Pound account number 01132301. IBAN GB49ARAY 3000830113230 1. Sort code 300083. SWIFT BIC code ARAY GB22. Please confirm your contribution at support@peacetv.tv.
Support Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran that He created the death and the life, for the purpose, of testing us.
Taqwa and truthfulness, humility and repentance, kindness and gratefulness.
Are you prepared for the final exam? Are you ready?
Generosity and tenderness give true value to life.
To answer the most important exam that you will ever face.
Dr. Jonathan Cazales.
Live your life purpose. On purpose.
Learn to utilize every moment of life to make it meaningful and precious in Live Your Life on Purpose. Every Sunday at 5:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 11:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV.
Although Christianity doesn't have a single credible source to justify her claims of the crucifixion, she yet continues to propagate her myth. They do this by hiding many of their deceptions behind cleverly designed doctrines. Did you know that Christianity stands or falls at the cross? So how did they do this? Join me for the series called The Cross Questions.
Probe the past that proves Christianity in practice is fictitious in The Cross Questioned. Every Monday at 6 p.m. and repeat telecast at 5:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. We've already given you the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam in regards to the importance of guarding one's tongue. And of course, when we say this, we need to guard the tongue, the pen, any form of expression, because at the end, what is given to people, the messages you send to people, will have the same effectiveness, whether this is done by a pen or by a tongue or by any form of art or any kind of expression, a photo for example, a video, anything that you may produce or make public and express your own opinion in, obviously will have its consequences. Therefore, we have to be very careful when we talk about the matter of freedom of opinion and expression. They have to be limited and guarded. The other agreement between the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Universal Islamic Declaration of Human Rights is the right of the person in contributing to the running of the affairs of the state, meaning to have participation in the general running of affairs in one's particular country or state, that has to be, again, governed by the laws and requirements, as long as they are fair and they're not intruding on anyone's right, nor are they depriving people of their own right to public participation. The freedom of security and not being at any threat or under any pressure when people have their own conviction of faith. This is important because as long as people are entitled to what they believe in, no one shall force them or coerce them to believe in any particular thing. Obviously, in the Islamic State, yes, you may believe in anything you'd like, but at the end you cannot express some of the things that are contradictory to the very basics of Islam out in the public because of the fear of creating some disagreement within the society and then probably leading to some hatred and then developing into confrontation. So in order to maintain safety and security in a Muslim state, and this is of course a challenge to Allah's law and to Allah's commandments, so that would be like a difference in terms of the details. Yes, we agree in principle, but when it comes to some of the applications, there would be some reservation from Islamic countries on the absolute meaning of any one of these rights and agreements with this declaration. So obviously it will be interpreted in a matter of a ratio, not an absolute application of the word. This is important. One of the other agreements is the right of people to have assemblies, to have meetings, to sit together, to establish peaceful organizations. Of course, that would be sometimes limited to some extent based on the circumstances. And the last piece of agreement between the two declarations is the right to have a rest from work, to enjoy some time off, some holiday, and so on. And that would be done, of course, in accordance with the particular agreement, particularly when it comes to celebrating the holidays or the celebrations that people need to attend to. So you cannot have, for example, work on Friday prayer. People have to stop to offer Salah, for example. Or you cannot have work in time on the day of Eid, where people have to attend Salat al-Eid and to celebrate and enjoy with their family. So that is the type of thing that we're talking about from work. And of course, that is a subject of agreement, but the days would be different based on the nature of the culture and religion and the value system being followed in any particular country. Now, the points of disagreement between the two declarations come from very basic disagreement regarding the freedom to choose your own religion and to change your religion. Of course, in Islam, it's not allowed for a Muslim to change his religion after being a faithful person, after having the conviction that he is a Muslim. You know, to change it is, as I said many times in this series, that you're putting things in a sort of a play with religion rather than to be unserious about religion. You have to be serious. And that would be very much the case with people in different cultures. Normally, those who tend to change their religion are very much people who have very strong doubts in their religion, and therefore you cannot express this in public. You may have your own reservations, you may have your own way of what to believe inside. Nobody is going to open your heart and know exactly what you have inside. But nonetheless, the general and main principles of Islam have to be respected and have to be maintained within the society by the Islamic State. And we always depend on the Islamic State for this. It's not in the hands of citizens or groups within a particular country to force these laws or to force these requirements. It's only the Muslim state that can do this. And of course, a Muslim state is not found in all the countries around the world. So that was the basic thing. The other point of disagreement was the right to have a nationality of any other country. Of course, some countries would not like to offer their nationality to everyone. They may make it very hard for someone to be a citizen of that country. That is their own choice. That's where the disagreement of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights with the Universal Islamic Declaration of Human Rights, because some Muslim countries did not like the idea of opening the doors for anyone to be eligible to have their own citizenship in their own respective country. And of course, I think that still be a point of discussion and controversy regarding this particular point. Another point was the right to have your own participation in the guilds and unions, such as labor unions and that sort of thing. Obviously, this can be done, but if they are not taking people towards challenging the government or trying to bring in ideas from foreign countries, which is not suitable for an Islamic state. Now, again, that is a subject of discussion and controversy. And of course, these countries, when this was done, was to safeguard the nature of the Muslim state as opposed to socialist countries where these unions and guilds are formed, or the influence coming from other countries, the capitalists, the socialists, the Marxists, and so on and so forth. The general agreement, as I said, between the two declarations is that the human being is dignified and respected, and we shall maintain this because from this particular point comes everything else. So justice and freedom are the two most important principles to be applied in any country. And of course, justice has to be absolute, where we have no problem with this. However, freedom would be a subject of discussion, and what are the limits to freedom, where your freedom ends and the freedom of others begin, where, to what extent can you take freedom in the sense of violating the belief of the state, the belief of the people and the culture in your own particular country or area. That is still a subject of greater discussion in this respect. Obviously, we will be coming into what the Islamic Declaration, the Universal Islamic Declaration of Human Rights, has to say on other things where there is a disagreement, because there will be, obviously, lots of areas of disagreement between the two declarations, which I will be, inshallah, dealing with in the coming episode. Until then, I leave you with Allah's care and protection. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ya wasi' al-afu, ya wasi' al-afu, wal-ghufran wal-karam, qad jirtu murtajifan min zallati al-qadam. ذنبي عظيم ذنبي عظيم وأرجو منك مغفرة يا ذا الجلال ويا ذا الجود والكرم.
Friendly message by Dr. Zakir. Islam prohibits killing of innocent human beings.
Every day, innocent human beings are being killed in different parts of the world. Most religions condemn the killing of innocent human beings. But Islam goes a step further and says in the glorious Quran, Surah Al-Maidah, chapter number 5. Verse number 32, if anyone kills a human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading corruption in the land, it would be as if he has killed the whole of humankind. It does not stop here, but continues. And if anyone saved a single human life, it would be as if he has saved the life of the entire humankind. Remember, please do not kill a single innocent human being, but rather save the whole of humankind by saving human lives.
Human life is precious. Peace TV, the solution for humanity.